the beginning, I would like to acknowledge a few students today who are volunteers. They're called the BSOS Ambassadors. They basically help with coordinating and directing the events for us. And today they are here, and there's three of them: Brenna Zhang, Esther Kaufman, and Javon Gord. And thank you very much. Today's lecture is under the Empowerment of Women and Peace series, one of a number of ongoing series organized by the Baha'i Chair to explore solutions to some of the world's greatest challenges and injustices, and to explore ways in which we can perhaps understand better these challenges in order to be able to remove the barriers from that prevent us from making this world a better place. So it's with great pleasure that I'd like to welcome Miss Lisa F. Jackson today, who will be introduced to you in a few minutes. Lisa, thank you for being here today. I also would like to extend my deep gratitude for the 7 organizations that are featured here today in the back, these tables that you see in the back. Some of you saw them as you walked in. And I'd like to name each of them because I think the work they do for us on this campus is so important. The University of Maryland's Counseling Center, Campus Advocates Respond and Educate to Stop Violence, the Campus Chaplain's Office, the Office of Student Conduct, the Department of Fraternity and Sorority Life, the Life Resident Life Office of Rights and Responsibilities, and the Office of Sexual Misconduct and Relationship Violence. Thank you very much for being here today. I would now like to introduce Ms. Catherine Carroll. In March of 22, Ms. Carroll became the Director of the Offices of Sexual Misconduct and Relationship Violence and Equity and Compliance at the University of Maryland. Ms. Carroll comes to us with more than 20 years of experience in working with survivors of domestic and sexual violence and has provided expert legal consultation for the American Bar Association, Commission on Domestic and Sexual Violence, and Rule of Law Initiative China Program. Ms. Carroll was the co-founder and executive director of the Sexual Violence Law Center in Seattle, Washington, where she worked to improve the civil and criminal legal response to survivors of sexual violence in Washington State. I could go on, but just to tell you a few more things, she has taught courses on sexual violence. She has a bar license from California and Washington, and she has had enormous experience in this area, and I think the University of Maryland is very lucky to have her here as its Title IX officer. Please welcome Ms. Catherine Carroll.
Well, thank you. That was very nice. I'm humbled by my introduction. I'm happy to be here. It's nice to see all of you. And I'm honored and humbled to just be a part of this event. It sounds like really amazing work that Lisa's been engaged in. And obviously, so has the center on campus. I want to tell you a little bit about our office. It is a new office on campus. We're located in the Armory. We are the Title IX office. We're not called that because a lot of people don't know what Title IX is. I'm hoping that our name is accessible and people will know where to find us and how to find us. It's why we did call out relationship violence, even though our school policy just is, refers to everything as sexual misconduct. It actually is inclusive of a lot of other forms of inappropriate conduct of a sexual nature. We are sort of responsible for investigating any complaints under Title IX, which has to do with sex discrimination, particularly that interrupts or somehow negatively impacts your experience as an employee or a student here at the University of Maryland. I've just finished policies and procedure updates to our policy with Dr. Lowe today. They're supposed to be posted tonight. So we do have a new policy, and we do have pretty in-depth student procedures about how we're going to deal with these cases. And I'm really happy to share with all of you that I've worked with the Department of Resident Life and the Office of Student Conduct, and they have been very, very helpful and supportive in ensuring that our processes on campus are respectful of everybody involved, that if someone who has been victimized does not want to participate in the process but still would like the person to be held accountable by the institution, that we can do that. We really want to make sure that no one is re-victimized by anything that the university is doing. So I'm happy about where we've ended up with our procedures, and I want to make sure that you all know that our office really intends to be a place of support and a place of safety for all of you, and to make sure that things are fair and equitable. And if you need to speak to people confidentially about anything that you may be experiencing, you should always contact the CARE to Stop Violence office. So in addition to filing complaints with my office is responsible for ensuring that training on campus is widespread and accurate, and hopefully creating behavioral change on campus. To that end, we're working very closely with the CARE to Stop Violence office to ensure that our bystander intervention trainings that we do on campus are consistent and well-informed with different perspectives, particularly around different forms of violence, whether it's sexual violence or dating violence or stalking. So you'll be seeing a lot of new things on campus in terms of training opportunities and how to engage all of you in different calls to action, which is another part of my office. We have a big public awareness campaign. Some of you may have seen it. It's called the Rule of Thumb. Some folks have been very upset about this because some of you may know the Rule of Thumb actually comes from a case in the 1868 out of North Carolina, State v. Rhodes, where the court ruled that a man was innocent because a man had a right to beat his wife with a switch as long as it was no wider than the width of his thumb. So we as feminists on campus, and I think people who want to recognize the history of violence against women in our own country, wanted to sort of take this back and say we're going to use this as a platform to educate the campus community about violence against women. So our campaign is intentional that it's the rule of thumb, and it's intentional that we want to be showing what good behavior looks like when we're asking for consent, what consent looks like, not just saying it's sexy, but that it's silence is not consent. If she says no, it's not consent. We really need to make sure that people understand what that means. So that's our campaign out there. We have a table in the back with brochures. I encourage you all to take them. And I'm just really flattered to be here, and I'm excited to be at the University of Maryland. I'm a West Coaster, so it's a new world for me out here. And so far, everyone on the campus has been really wonderful. So thank you, and I'm excited to hear Lisa.
A question in which the Baha'i Chair for World Peace is deeply interested in is the persistent and subordination of women and violence against women across all cultures and regions of the world. Gender inequality presides in the home, in the workplace, in politics, in the educational system, and in the shocking levels of violent acts against women. Sexual assault and violence against women, the focus of today's lecture, presents a significant challenge to all societies as a whole. Such violence is performed in many forms, to include physical and sexual abuse, mutilation, and murder. Women and girls throughout the world reside in cultures that not only sustain violence against them, but find that such acts of violence are tolerated and overlooked. Violence against women is entrenched in the structural inequalities between women and men. Changes in law and policy are essential to the elimination of violence against women. But at a more crucial level, the eradication of violence against girls and women demands changes at the level of culture, attitudes, and beliefs. Equality of women and men is the ultimate goal to be achieved and a critical condition for the advancement of society. To enlighten our thinking and understanding of this very important and highly complex topic, we are fortunate to have with us today Ms. Lisa F. Jackson. Ms. Jackson's exceptional documentary films are a window into the raw reality of what women are forced to endure as victims of sexual violence. Lisa F. Jackson has been making documentary films for over 35 years, work that has brought her numerous awards that include, among others, an Emmy Award and Sundance Jury Prize winner. She studied filmmaking at MIT with Richard Leacock and has directed and or edited dozens of films for PBS. Sex Crimes Unit, her recent film, is an unprecedented verite portrait of prosecutors in Manhattan District Attorney's Office as they work to bring justice to victims of sexual violence. It aired on HBO in June 2011. Jackson shot The Greatest Silence, Rape in Congo, in the war zones of the Democratic Republic of Congo. It won a special jury prize for documentaries at the 2008 Sundance Film Festival, earned 2 Emmy nominations, and was broadcast on HBO. She currently is finishing a documentary, It Happened Here, that is about the epidemic of sexual assault on college campuses and the burgeoning movement of survivor activists who have begun holding their schools accountable. Tom Shales of the Washington Post has praised her documentaries as superb and outstanding. John O'Connor commented in the New York Times that producer-director Lisa F. Jackson is remarkably adept in getting her subjects to speak frankly and thoughtfully. And the Christian Science Monitor noted that she takes on difficult subjects with intelligence and courage. Lisa Jackson received the 2012 Muse Awards, and where she was honored as the documentary filmmaker for her documentary Sex Crimes Unit. I'd like to share with you just a quick segment of what she said upon her acceptance of this award. And it relates to documentary filmmakers, which she is one of the outstanding ones. She said, "We dish out spinach in a world where most people prefer ice cream. We are the ones paddling on about human rights abuses in the Congo, gender justice in Colombia. We want people to be fixated, as we are, about things like rape kit backlogs, the death of small farms, malfeasance of drug companies, restorative justice, and profoundly fraught origins of the Barbie doll." She continues, "Our films and their subjects become serial obsessions and make us kind of distracted and half mad sometimes for months and years at a time." Ms. Jackson, we thank you for your dishing out spinach instead of ice cream. We thank you for your unrelenting, arduous work in bringing to our attention the hard facts about the ongoing scourge of violence against women throughout the world. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome our distinguished speaker, Ms. Lisa F. Jackson.
I'm also in charge of the audio-video portion of the program, so there might be some glitches. But thank you so much, Dr. Mahmoudi, and to the Baha'i Chair for having me here today. This is an honor, and it's my first time that I've ever actually combined a lot of my films together into one little package. I usually, show a whole film and then take questions. So today is kind of different. But as Dr. Mahmoudi said, I've been making films for a long time on a wide diversity of subjects, from the Barbie doll, the New York Mets. Emily Dickinson did a series of films on police detectives who work with psychics. But about 10 years ago, I have been sort of obsessed with doing films about sexual violence. And it's a subject that is taboo in many cultures, and even on enlightened college campuses like this, it's a topic that few people feel comfortable talking about. But in the 10 years that I've been doing this specific work, I've met dozens and actually hundreds of women and many men who have suffered the trauma of sexual assault. And all the women that I've talked to, whether it's in Bogota, Colombia, in the jungles in the Congo, in Manhattan, or on American college campuses, they all express the hope and the need for some semblance of justice, some acknowledgement of the crime that had been committed against them and to their minds and bodies. Today I wanted to share with you some of the stories that I've been told by these women who were brave enough to speak out about their rapes and committed enough to fight for the justice that they and all survivors deserve. It all started in 2005 when I began researching a film that I wanted to make about the female experience of war. Most of what we understand about war comes from a male combat narrative. But modern wars have a profound effect on civilian populations, particularly on women and children. And those voices, those stories, were absolutely absent from current and historical war narratives. I wanted to go with my camera and ask women and girls to tell me their stories. I wanted to go to a conflict zone, and now I get to use my incredible skills here, to a place where rape was being used as a weapon of war. And I ended up going to the worst place first. In 2006, I traveled to the Democratic Republic of the Congo, a country where a bloody, chaotic civil war has been raging for almost 15 years. It is a war over resources, especially the minerals without which we cannot make our cell phones or laptop computers. And this war has killed almost 6 million people, and women and girls have been particularly and brutally targeted. Some call it ground zero in the war against women, and hundreds of thousands of women and girls have been horribly raped. I spent a long time in a small village in the bush called Bunyakiri, and women of all ages would line up until there was no light to shoot because they wanted to talk to someone. They wanted to share their stories, the stories of their assaults. They wanted to talk to someone who would listen to them, believe them, not judge them, and would defend them in a world that seemed absolutely oblivious to their plight. So I am going to go to this clever... No, yes, I'm going to show you the beginning of that film, The Greatest Silence, and...
Ubu sigaye nza nabona byarahindutse ni wowe nakunze ni wowe
na nabikande kana njuba kanibaka alikuwa tumutumwe.
Rape is a method in this environment to create continued instability and dominance is very prominent, and it is without question the worst environment that I have seen.
Mm-hmm. masiku kwaka nangise kujipiganisha. Ananza ambia watoto wake aseme peke ndo nilipendaka wanikamata.
Ces femmes ne parlent pas et ce silence tue. Le silence tue des milliers de femmes dans les forêts du Congo. Voilà.
Tena meza na byo tina kitanda kufunja wakanikalisha chini. Hivi niko hapa nikaona soja inji. Siku utakucha. Sie na ikiri. Naanza ni mlodo. Sipende nione ile nini. Mimi naona wanakuya tafile baliingia kama nyumba. 12 na mitorola 12.
Ça. Pourquoi utiliser le sexe pour humilier, pour vaincre quelqu'un, pour amener quelqu'un à quitter son village? Pourquoi utiliser le sexe? Je crois que c'est la monstruosité en fait de notre siècle.
Pour mettre fin, pour diminuer les cas de viol, je crois la première des choses, il faut d'abord lutter contre l'impunité.
If a society can't protect women and kids, what kind of society is that? It becomes just a real jungle. That's what we are living in. It's a real jungle.
Mina mukamata ya kinguvu, kama na nishinda, mina ita venzangu wa nisaidi.
Unasikia wanaume 12 wanakupita ako. Mika maumivu ya mwili, wanatuala mpaka ya bunduki, wanakutia chini ya mwili. Wanakuia watoto wanakuambia wewe kule wale watoto. Tukabaki wajane, waume kutukataa na wengine kufa. Wandugu wametukataa. Tujui tufanye nini wala tukimbilie wapi.
Et puis qui dit une femme? La femme c'est la mère de la nation. Qui viole une femme viole toute une nation.
Tuone kama tutapumzika. Tukakufa na ile hali ni ya busuni tu. Ni ya busuni kabisa. Tunaona hali hii hali tuko nayo. Nchi yetu inaharibika, inasorotwa na vita. Hatuna furaha katika roho zetu. Si hata mwanamke hata mwanaume hatuna furaha. Hatuna furaha kabisa.
In that clip that you just saw, you heard soldiers confessing to multiple rapes, and later in the film I talked to 5 or 6 more, and they're confessing basically to war crimes, and they know that there's going to be no repercussions from these confessions, because in the Congo a culture of impunity rules. The Congolese government passed a kind of sweeping anti-rape law in 2008. But over and over again, I heard about stories about the futility of enforcement, about rapists who would pay a bribe of $1 or $2 and get out of jail, about jails where actually there were no locks on the cell doors, and about women who faced brutal reprisals if they dared to denounce their attackers. With the rare exception, the women in the Congo are left without the possibility of justice and without the solace of peace. My experience in the Congo made it clear to me how important justice is to survivors of sexual violence. But it wasn't until my next film that I understood how long it took for women in this country to have access to that justice. In 2010, I began shooting a film in the sex crimes unit in the Manhattan District Attorney's Office. And this was the first unit in the country dedicated to the prosecution of crimes of rape and sexual violence. In researching the film, I found out that until the 1970s, a raped woman could not prosecute her assailant unless she had 3 pieces of evidence or corroboration that a crime had been committed. You had to prove that the assault had been sexual in nature. You had to prove that there had been force involved. So if you struggled with your assailant and got beat up, it really helped your case. And you had to have independent corroboration as to the assailant's identity. And that meant, in the category of crime least likely to be witnessed by anybody else, there had to be independent evidence of what the victim was saying. These laws found their roots in 17th century English common law that was all about protecting a man's honor. Laws that said that the charge of rape is so easy to bring and so difficult to defend against that it must be held to a higher standard than any other crime. And it wasn't until 1974 that the New York State Legislature voted to eliminate the corroboration requirement. The night before that vote, the lead editorial in the New York Times said it was abhorrent to think that a man could be convinced solely on the unsupported testimony of a woman. 1974. It took many years and the unrelenting pressure from the women's movement before victims of sexual violence in this country gained full access to the justice system. Not only were the corroboration laws taken off the books, but marital rape was criminalized. Rape shield laws were passed that made a victim's sexual history off limits in the trial. And in many states, the statute of limitations laws were changed, making rape a Class A felony. Here is a short clip from that film, Sex Crimes Unit. And in this scene, the two prosecutors, Colleen Balbert and Jennifer Skolko, have just heard the verdict in the case of a prostitute who dared cry rape. And, oh, I think I've lost it. No, I haven't lost it. Hey. Okay, here we go. Yay.
Yes. Juror number 8, is that your verdict?
Yes.
Juror number 9, is that your verdict?
As soon as I get back to my desk, I'm going to call her, let her know. She's going to be thrilled. Guilty.
Yeah,
excellent job. Give me a hug.
I know. You did so good.
Team Pace!
Team Pace!
Guilty!
Yeah!
On everything.
Get a hug.
Thank you.
Oh,
that's
she
did that.
Yay!
All right, guys, go call everybody.
I am.
It's going to be great news for their weekend.
I know.
I've never, like, felt more just, like, that sense of, like, just communication for her. Like, we'll call me inside out.
Really,
guilty. Guilty on everything. Just calm down. I know. You did it. You did it. You know, they believed you. You really did a tremendous thing by reporting it and by coming forward and by being honest about everything and by telling the truth. And I'm so happy that this is, that you got the justice in the end. I really am.
You should be. You should be. Tears of joy are okay. There's nothing wrong with crying.
Ed? Colleen? Guilty. Everything.
Yay!
It's Colleen. Guilty. You heard that?
Everyone around this office is going to start coming in here and be like, oh my god, I heard!
Oh my god, oh my god! I was going to say, do you want to grab a drink?
Yeah.
Get Artie. Tell Artie to come.
I will.
Hi Sarah, it's Colleen Balbert. I just wanted to let you know that the defendant was convicted of all 8 counts. So thank you again so much.
All right, I'm sure I'll talk to you over the weekend.
Have a good weekend.
Have a nice time tonight. Go celebrate.
I am. I'm going to have a drink with Skolko probably.
Okay. See you later.
Okay, bye.
Bye.
He was crying in court. So, yeah, I didn't feel bad for him. Yeah. That's exactly right. I've seen 2 victims cry in my office because of what he did to them. So I just, you know, I don't have sympathy. 2 times. 2-time convicted rapist. Is that unbelievable?
I love it in the film when Colleen says to Cynthia, the complainant, I'm so glad that you finally got the justice that you deserve. And she fought so hard in that trial. But that justice will never be the case for women who don't come forward. And in the US, over 60% of sexual assaults are never reported to the police. And 97% of rapists will not spend a day in jail. And in other countries, that other democracies, that number is appallingly higher. In 2007, I started traveling to Colombia, where an intractable civil war has had a devastating effect on the civilian population. 4 million Colombians, a tenth of the population, are internally displaced. They're basically refugees in their own country, forced from their homes by the violence. Displacement makes women and girls even more vulnerable to sexual assault. Groups had begun campaigning to make women aware of their rights as victims and to push prosecutors to question paramilitaries and members of the Colombian army about sexual violence, and I wanted to find out how much progress was actually being made. And again, this was another chapter in my The Voices of Women in War. Through an NGO in Bogota that provides legal help to displaced women, I met Rosa, Marcela, and Sandra, who became the main characters in Three Women, a film that I started shooting in 2007. And now, here is a clip from Tres Mujeres. So.
Mi Bogotá, hoy te quiero cantar, bella ciudad. Donde yo era
a la orden. Pues vivíamos bien, todo era tranquilo, vivíamos en una finca ganadera.
Yo era una mujer muy alegre. Yo bailaba, yo salía, yo caminaba, yo jugaba así.
Yo tengo fotos con el papá.
Entonces yo lo que sabía era manejar los caballos, coger café, sembrar yuca, trabajo de hombres.
Mi hija Vanessa tenía 11 años cuando fue violada por un desconocido.
Que me volvió nada, mejor dicho, yo pensaba que yo lloraba porque yo decía, no, mi cara no me va a quedar igual.
Y lo que hice fue desnudarme, porque me lo exigieron, con un revólver en la cabeza. Y yo dije, cerrar los ojos, que sea lo que Dios quiera.
De eso pues nos siguieron mandando anónimos, que si no no salíamos de allá, pues que pasaba lo mismo a nosotros.
Entonces es cuando se decide que hay que huir. Anocheció y no amanecimos, nos vinimos con la ropa. Bogotá es el epicentro del desplazamiento en Colombia.
Yo defino el desplazamiento como un dolor, como una muerte lenta.
Por estar vivas, por estar bien.
Las tres mosqueteras.
Salud.
Bueno, yo creo que la meta de este año es tener nombre y apellido completo de la organización.
Yo le dije a ella, tiene que ir a denunciar antes de moverse a Bogotá.
Ellos te llenaron un papel y ya, y eso fue toda la denuncia.
Vale el riesgo que busquen a esos hombres.
Yo no quiero callarme, yo quiero decirlo, yo quiero publicarlo, yo quiero que la gente se entere de que sí pasa, de que sí me pasó.
Hoy lo vamos a hacer ante la fiscalía, entonces ya va a digamos, hacer una prueba dentro del proceso.
Casi ni se ve.
Son tres años.
O sea, tengo muchas cosas, tengo muchos temores, muchas tristezas por dentro. No sé qué voy a hacer.
Yo creo que si yo nunca hubiera contado lo que me ha pasado a mí, nunca hubiera denunciado y nunca eso, creo que tendría la familia perfecta.
Y la vida de Sandra se destruyó porque ella confesó algo que no había confesado y lo confesó porque ella creía que había justicia. Y la destrucción de Sandra es esa.
Es que el mundo sin mujeres no sería mundo.
Uno se cae y uno no tiene que quedarse ahí esperando de aunque algún imbécil venga a darle la mano.
Porque si no es solo Sandra y Elena, somos muchas.
So, let me go back to... Yes, no, I didn't get that. There we go. As I said in the film, they all pushed the limits of a system that promised them justice, but none of them had the strength to keep on pushing. The last time I filmed with them was in early 2013, and Sandra and Vanessa had both dropped their cases, and a pregnant Marcella went back to her abusive boyfriend and has disappeared. So it's time to ask, why are rape and sexual assault so shrouded in myths and prejudices? Why is it universally true that only a tiny fraction of these crimes are ever reported? Why are survivors so universally shamed and stigmatized? Why is rape still so different from any other crime? I don't know the answers to all these intractable questions, but a veteran prosecutor I know got close to the core of the problem when she told me that sexual assault is the only crime I've ever encountered that people view as victim precipitated, that there was something this woman did that made her a victim. This blame the victim attitude is pretty much ubiquitous, but nowhere have I encountered it more forcefully than in making my most recent film, It Happened Here, about sexual assaults on American college campuses. First, a little background. I don't know how much you all know about this, but I was really appalled in researching this film to find out facts like, the risk of rape victimization on college campuses is 1 in 5 girls. Thousands of students are sexually assaulted every school year, but it's impossible to know how vast the problem actually is, as only between 5 and 10% of these crimes are reported. When it comes to reporting, student victims anticipate and are often met with humiliation, apathy, and disbelief. Assault survivors fall into debilitating depressions, many drop out of school, and last year one committed suicide. In the real world, people go to jail for these crimes. On campuses, their assailants rarely face consequences. But there is a burgeoning movement of student survivors and activists who are working to change this. It Happened Here tells the story of women in 3 different schools, at the University of Connecticut, at Amherst, and Vanderbilt in Nashville. And it follows their journey from victim to survivor, then to activist, and potential game changer. I want to share with you some selected scenes from what is a work in progress. The film is not actually finished. The sound is very rough. The pictures are, the graphics are crude. So what you're going to see may at times be a little bumpy, but I hope you'll find it no less moving. Some of the clips are taking a little bit out of context, but here is 20 minutes from the beginning and the end of It Happened Here.
Sexual violence is one of those issues we all wish didn't exist. Every school would like to believe it's immune from sexual violence, but the facts suggest otherwise. According to one widely referenced study, 1 in 5 women is sexually assaulted while in college.
Letter to everybody, the world in general, about what had happened to me, in the hopes that somebody somewhere would read it and realize what was going on. On May 25th, 2011, I was raped by an acquaintance in Crossett Dormitory on Amherst College campus. I blocked the rape from my mind and tried to convince myself that it hadn't happened. I spent most of my spring semester an emotional wreck. I began going to the campus's sexual assault guidance counselor. In short, I was told, no, you can't change dorms. Pressing charges would be useless. He's about to graduate. There's not much we can do.
Every time it was, how drunk were you? And no one believed me when I told them I was sober.
Are you sure it was rape? It might have just been a bad hookup.
You should forgive and forget.
There's no justice at college when you're assaulted. On May 5th, I was admitted into the psychiatric ward for depression and suicidal thoughts. Silence has the rusty taste of shame, a fellow survivor once wrote. I had been far too silent, far too ashamed. For the first time, I told my story, and I was not ashamed. My letter was published in the Amherst Student newspaper, and it went viral. Within a few hours, it crashed the server. I began almost instantly receiving dozens of messages, and it slowly rose into hundreds of messages telling me that the same thing had happened to them. After reading your story, I was simultaneously horrified, comforted, and inspired. I too was also raped on campus, and my school handled it poorly as well. My sister was assaulted. The college did everything they could to hide it, even going so far as to call her a liar.
A lot of the students described situations where administrators discouraged them from pursuing rape complaints within the college judicial system.
And then it spread to other news organizations, and it became millions of people were talking about
it. She told me that the assault wasn't that serious.
She had met with my rapist and that he didn't seem like the type of person who would do something like that.
She told me that I wouldn't have a strong case and that reporting it would lose me a lot of friends.
Expecting support and compassion. I received neither.
No means yes, yes means anal. No means yes, yes means anal. No means yes, yes means anal. No means yes.
The victim says she was raped by each man, one man allegedly more than once.
The survey in question asked, who would you rape and why? Who would you rape?
All in capitals, rape, rape, rape. It's college boys, live it up.
New developments now in the case of four Morehouse College students accused of rape.
He graduated with honors. I will not graduate from Amherst.
He will be allowed to come back to Oxy in the fall.
The school is allowing a serial offender back on campus next December.
We haven't had the problem!
3 years! 15 reported sexual assault! We haven't had the problem!
Students at USC staged a protest, stating that the school's administrators have failed to respond to rape claims.
Where was the last time
you heard about a rape on campus?
What?
What are you talking about? It's like rampant.
It's rampant?
It's important to note that 6% of men on college campuses are rape survivors.
I had a close friend who was raped last year. He's from Amherst as well. And he recently just took his own life over the summer because of it.
Survivors of sexual assault are left feeling alone, misunderstood, and irrational. This treatment is not only unethical, it's also against the law.
Learning the law changed everything.
We must shed light on these horrific events so that people know this is a national issue. I have an obligation to stand with other survivors to stop this culture of violence from happening to the next generation of students.
Students are not going to be silent the way they have in the past.
I'm coming forward now because I want to break the silence.
You don't always immediately think that this kind of thing can happen at your school and this kind of thing can happen to you. And when it does, it's very eye-opening and it becomes like itself in itself a call to action.
Survivors are coming forward and continuing this fight for justice.
I guess I'd feel guilty if I didn't do everything in my power to help stop all this.
That was a sneak preview. Hopefully it'll be broadcast later this year, and hopefully you'll have me back to show the whole film. So the Title IX movement has become a juggernaut. And you probably heard this, but in January, President Obama appointed a special task force to look into the issue of sexual assault on college campuses and launched the, I have things to show you. Wait a minute. There are slides that actually show. Okie dokie. Yep, here it is. There we go. They launched these websites, not only encouraging survivors to report, but to give them the tools and support they need. The number of schools under investigation by the Department of Education when I started working on this film 2 years ago was 3, and last we checked it was over 70. And the young women who are filing these complaints against their schools are committed to removing barriers to justice, making it easier for others to come forward, providing a vocabulary and a template for changes that need to happen, and inspiring a long overdue conversation about the intersection between women and justice on the path to a better world. Thank you.
Just quickly, I wanted to say, maybe because we're a small audience, we will just take questions from the floor. I was going to ask you to write them on the note cards. But I think if you can speak loud enough, if you could please address your questions to Ms. Jackson.
Anybody? What other fun slides do I have? Oh, there's more.
Yes. Lisa, have you interviewed any campus administrators in terms of their responsibility in relation to these Title IX complaints?
Well, we asked for interviews with Susan Herbst, the president of UConn, who turned us down. The president of Vanderbilt turned us down. But Biddy Martin, the president of Amherst, we did do a long interview with her. And of course, Angie was not assaulted on her watch. And she's done an incredible job to bring students into the conversation. The Amherst website has a completely transparent, like Title IX. And the Clery Act, which was referred to, it was an act that was passed in 1985. There was this woman named Jeanine Clery who was stalked, raped, and murdered at Lehigh. And the campus apparently had a very high assault rate that was never publicized. So under the Clery Act, campuses are compelled to make known whenever crimes occur on their campus. So they have an actual, on the Amherst website, it says how many Clery Act complaints there have been, how many assaults there have been. So a lot of schools don't, you know, are obviously terrified that alumni aren't going to give money if, you know, their schools are, you know, last year it said there were 0 rapes on campus, and this year there were 15. But as Angie says to the administrators at Drexel, it means that not that rapes are going up, because the rapes have always been there, but that you are doing something right and that students are coming forward. Yes.
Really so interesting. My name is Liz Marion, and I teach global public health. And I use Half the Sky, the book Half the Sky.
I think women.
Did you all hear?
The question is, you know, the difference between the Congo, Colombia, and campuses, and there really aren't many. Women, especially in the Congo, I found that women really wanted to own their own narratives. And I think that's true for women everywhere. I mean, if something like this happens to them, it it has horrible psychological repercussions to keep it repressed, to not tell, to not seek justice. None of these girls had, there were no repercussions at all for their assailants, and that's something that colleges need to pay attention to. But in terms of initiating those conversations, it's kind of the same everywhere you go. And the need to own your narrative and the need to be believed is something I found everywhere that I went, in the Congo, in Colombia, and on American college campuses. And ditto in the dozens of cases I observed the prosecutors putting together. And 85% of the assaults that they prosecute at the Rape Crimes Unit in the Manhattan DA's office, 85% are acquaintance rapes. So they have a really, the same hard issues they face are faced by college administrators, I'm sure, but these cases need to be heard and justice needs to be delivered in every single instance. A guy, yay.
Hi, my name is Elon, and I'm a student here at the University of Maryland. Our society, our culture really advocates this message of don't get raped versus don't rape. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if you have any advice or steps of how individuals in schools can go about reversing that message.
By not putting that message out there. I mean, Linda Fairstein, who started the Rape Crimes Unit, is the one who said to me that it's the only crime in 40 years as an attorney that she'd ever found that was perceived to be somehow victim precipitated. And that idea that women are asking for it is one that permeates this culture. And it needs to be reversed. I mean, they used to say that if men got pregnant, birth control would be a sacrament. Well, I think if men got assaulted on the scale that women are being assaulted, I think rape would be taken a lot more seriously. And it's even worse on a college campus because this is, some place you've always wanted to be. It's where you're going to spend your next 4 years, and it can completely upset a woman's career path. She can end up dropping out. And I think that men really need to be engaged in this conversation. I think it's absolutely important. And, David Lisak, who we interviewed, said that 90% of the rapes are committed by 7% of the guys. So it's not like every guy is a rapist, but there are serial rapists on college campuses, and they continue to get away with it. And they will continue to get away with it after they graduate. They definitely found that in the military. That most of the assaults were being perpetrated by the same people over and over and over again because of a climate of impunity, the sort of climate that is pervasive in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. That should be replicated on college campuses is absurd. So I think that students need to speak out, and men really need to become engaged in this because it's not just a women's issue. And I really appreciate your question. Way in the back.
Do you think for colleges and universities, the issue is a lack of interest or a lack of resources or knowledge of how to, fix the issue?
Maybe I could bring up your Title IX coordinator to answer that one. I mean, I think it's a combination of all of those things. I don't think they knew the extent. No, come on up. I don't think colleges knew the extent of the problem until, the last couple, 3 years when women have been coming forward in droves. And I don't think,
they knew.
What?
They knew.
Okay.
So
they knew.
I'm sorry. I mean, I know that sounds like a blanket statement, but sometimes we know.
Yeah.
We just don't want to know. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Well, Biddy Martin says that they got caught flat-footed. That they didn't know the problem was as bad as it was, and I don't know. Do you have anything to say?
Well, I just want to add that this is really common. I mean, you can look at the scandals in the. Religious institutions, the denial, the pervasiveness of how we deny how much sexual abuse actually occurs in our communities, in our churches, in our schools. I mean, it's everywhere. So it's not like it's unique to college campuses. It's just that we as a society don't really want to recognize it. And that I think there's a lot of misogynist messaging that we all get and reinforce. Mm-hmm. And so within that larger context in universities, they don't know how to deal with it. They're freaking out, much like I think you could say about the Catholic Church. They just move people. You know, they don't know how to deal with it. So it's easier to sort of like marginalize it, which is what we tend to do with things we don't understand. And I just think that it's somewhat predictable. Like, you know, it's not anything new. This has been going on for a long time. It's going on in high schools, you know. But now that schools are being really called out on it with the advocacy of students in a way that they never have before, they have to step up their game and actually deal with it. But the irony of it is, you know, these laws, I mean, they've been around a long time. There's nothing new about a lot of this. They should have been doing this 10, 15 years ago. But nobody knows really how to do it. And what we know about sexual assault and sexual violence is not what is pervasive in our media culture, right? The rape myths about provoking a crime, what you're wearing, where you went, where you were drinking, all of the crap out there is what people sort of think, right or wrong, because they're not actually truly educated about the facts. So a lot of it's also just education. And that's the irony for me, is we're in higher education and we seem to know less than the rest of the world about what's going on with sexual violence.
No, that's absolutely right. And you know, and a lot of people think that most rape reports are false, but the Department of Justice has, you know, you ask the LISAC, for instance, talks about, you know, he gives these lectures at police academies, and they are convinced that 90% of rapes are false reports, and it's actually between 3% and 9%. So, I mean, these attitudes are so deeply embedded in our psyches and in our culture that, you know, I have such hope for this student movement. That it's really going to begin the jumpstart a long overdue conversation.
Maybe one more question.
Well, I hope that a male filmmaker will make that film. You know, there was a good friend of Angie's, who was a male student at Amherst, was raped 2 years ago and committed suicide last year. And I met men in the Congo who had been raped. They're a small percentage. It's an important percentage. Personally, I'm not going to make that film, but I hope it is made because those voices absolutely need to be heard. And straight men, too. I mean, it's not just gay men that I've met. Yeah. So I may park the sexual violence topic for a while after this film comes out. But.
Let's thank Ms. Jackson again. I just wanted to thank you again for coming out this afternoon, despite the rain, or should I say the floods and other things, tornado watches. It's really nice to have you here to hear this very important presentation, especially because we are on a college campus and we have to make sure that we are not bystanders, that we do more than that in terms of addressing this issue and becoming more aware of this very important area of violence against women in general. And I would really like to thank Ms. Jackson again for being here today. It is really wonderful to see the creativity that her work represents in every way. And we just want her to make more and more of these documentaries. As you can see, these are just some of her films that are featured on the slide, but there are some, if you would like to purchase some today, just contact Ms. Awet Sellers in the back and she can assist you with that. I just want to invite you to other programs that are coming up this semester with the Baha'i Chair, sponsored by the Baha'i Chair for World Peace. This one is coming up very soon on structural racism and the root causes of prejudice. October 29th, co-sponsored with the Department of Sociology's Critical Race Initiative We have two very important speakers who will continue this very important and critical conversation about structural racism, which the Baha'i Chair started last spring. Next, we will have the Solidarity Across Differences series, including Dr. Rayshawn Ray from the Sociology Department and Dr. Beth Dorrit Cohen, from the University of Maryland, a very important symposium about how, even though we have many differences, how much we can bring solidarity despite such differences. And finally, this semester, Women in Conflicts, Past and Present, the Syrian Case, presented by Professor Fruma Zaks from Haifa University in Haifa, Israel. We hope that you will please make sure that you attend these lectures and to keep up with other programs in the both this fall and in spring. We ask you to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and we now have an Instagram. And also our website is there. Please stay around and enjoy the company of Ms. Jackson. And if you have other questions, of course, this would be the time to ask her. And there are some light refreshments in the back, so we hope that you will partake. And we again thank you for coming out this afternoon. Thank you.